I Good morning.
Morning, how are you, sir?
Fine.
Good.
You too?
Yeah.
Yeah, good.
Well, I think the DSG is kind of pissed. Distinguished. Yes. Now, what I was saying was, I didn't need to. We're coming on a mission to good morning. The President of the General Assembly, the Deputy Secretary General, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of UNFPA, UN Women, and UNICEF, the co-sponsors of this high-level forum on adolescent girls, I wish to extend a warm welcome to all of you. This is truly a momentous occasion for for the international community and provides an unprecedented opportunity to focus on the power of girls to drive progress and transform our world. Less than 5 months ago, here in New York, members of member states adopted an ambitious new agenda for development by prominently featuring girls' rights in the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. The international community has responded enthusiastically to the evidence that shows that investing in girls yield huge returns. The new agenda acknowledges that increased attention to the health of the world's adolescent girls, including their sexual and reproductive health, as well as their education, employment, and empowerment, is a necessary condition for success. It calls powerfully for a stronger focus on adolescent girls across sectors. Today, there are 600 million adolescent girls with specific needs, challenges, and aspirations for the future. These girls have the potential to jumpstart economic growth and spur the innovation needed for a sustainable future. Their welfare is fundamental to achieving key economic and social objectives, including a competitive labor force, sustained economic growth, improved governance, and vibrant civil societies. This, however, is not the case for many of the adolescent girls living in our societies today. Many continue to suffer severe disadvantages and exclusion merely for being young and being female. Millions of adolescent girls live in poverty, are burdened by gender discrimination and inequality, and are subject to multiple forms of violence, abuse, and exploitation, such as child labor, child marriage, and other harmful practices. For many girls, puberty marks an accelerated trajectory into inequality. It also represents a critical window for the preventive and protective investments we must make if we are serious about achieving full gender equality. When girls are free to define their lives and enjoy their rights, they not only enjoy better health and healthier children, they are better to contribute to national development as economic actors and entrepreneurs, helping their countries reap the demographic dividend and driving economic growth. As the leaders of both today and tomorrow, they can be a force for social cohesion and progress and peace. The success of the 2030 Agenda, which calls us to leave no one behind, will be measured in how well we are collectively able to build a world in which girls have no limits on their aspirations for the future, and no matter where they live, and no matter where they are born. A world where adolescent girls have access to health information and services, and possess the knowledge and confidence they need to make the right choices for a healthy life. A world where every girl can enter freely into a productive adulthood because she is educated and has the opportunity for decent work. A world where girls are treated with dignity and respect in equal measure with boys, and where, regardless of their sex, young people's human rights are promoted and respected. I dare say that it is our responsibility and the burden we carry that this generation of adolescent girls we will measure our success of the Agenda 2030 by them. So this is the SDG generation, and we have to make sure we do everything to protect them. UNFPA, UN Women, and UNICEF will continue to work with governments, the United Nations system, young people, civil society, and the private sector. And the private sector is here today, and I want to welcome members of the private sector to make this become a reality. We call on you to join us in committing to the bold pledge of the 2030 agenda to leave no one behind, prioritize investment in girls as a smart choice for the health and prosperity of all our nations and the world. Let me welcome you once again and urge you to participate actively in the discussion that we'll have throughout this day. I thank you. Excellencies, we're honored today to have the President of the General Assembly and the Deputy Secretary General with us. And we are expecting the Executive Director of UN Women. And amongst us is a representative of young people who would make opening remarks. So let me yield the ground to the President of the General Assembly to make his remarks. Your Excellency, Mr. President.
Thank you, Undersecretary Dr. Babatunde Osetimen, Honorable Ministers, Deputy Secretary General Jan Eliasson, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. On Tuesday, in this very room, many of us gathered to celebrate International Women's Day. At that occasion, we were inspired by many excellent speakers, but I was particularly moved by the courage of one young woman in particular, Mrs. Monica Singh, who was attacked with acid at an age of 18 after refusing to accept a marriage proposal. She suffered burns all over her body, losing 95% of her skin, but despite the immense pain, the risk to her life, and the change of her appearance, she didn't give in. She decided to fight for her own survival because, as she said, I believe my life has a purpose. Her story made it crystal clear to me why we must be relentless in the fight for gender equality and why we are gathered also here today. If a young woman is capable of overcoming such an attack on her life, on her freedom, and on her future, just think how much more she could achieve if society was actually on her side, supporting her, empowering her. But for many girls, and especially for those living in poverty, adolescence marks a time of heightened vulnerability where that support is non-existent, a time of greater risk for marginalization, discrimination, and horrific human rights violations. It is up to all of us to reduce those risks and empower these girls. And with the 2030 Agenda, we have created a real opportunity to do so. Since its adoption in September last year, I have often said that this agenda is truly revolutionary. I say this because the vision it presents of a better world, and because of its potential to mobilize real action to make that vision a reality. That potential derives from the fact that its message of hope was enthusiastically endorsed by the heads of state and government from every UN member state last September, and from the fact that we are building on the solid progress achieved by the Millennium Development Goals, and from the momentum that's being generated among many stakeholders around key transformative areas such as investing in social protection floors or shifting away from fossil fuels. Clearly, investment in the 600 million adolescent girls in our world can be similarly transformative. Imagine the contribution to society that they could make if we remove all legal, social, and economic barriers to the empowerment, if we prioritize investment in their education and health, if we support them to realize their human rights, and if we tackle harmful gender stereotypes head on. imagine the positive impact of such changes in their own lives, for their families, their communities, and for broader societal and economic development. In fact, such a transformation, particularly empowered women joining the labor market, has been the greatest change in the global north in my lifetime, and it has brought incredible benefits for all of society. The job of empowering adolescent girls now, however, is the responsibility of all of us. And it's a job for you and me, for governments and communities, for the UNFPA, and for all of the UN systems, for adolescent girls themselves and their male peers, for the private sector, for religious leaders, and for civil society. It's the right thing to do, and it's a smart thing to do. I therefore encourage all of you here today to identify concrete actions that we will take and new alliances that we will build to help realize the rights and potential of our world's adolescent girls. I thank you.
Let me thank Mr. President for his remarks and setting the tone, and to welcome my sister from Zile to the table. Let me now turn to the Deputy Secretary General to make his remarks. Yes, Jim.
President Lykketoft, Dr. Osetemin, dear Babatunde, Executive Director Mlambo Njuka, dear from Zile, Dr. Giamai Boateng, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you very much to the organizers for this important event. More and more leaders and more people around the world appreciate the role of adolescent girls and the importance of focusing on and dealing with their situation. Let me, at the very outset, pay tribute to them for their bravery and for their integrity in the face of very often cases of flagrant injustice and discrimination. Let me give you some examples. It should not take an act of courage to go to school, but in too many parts of the world, girls risk their lives, in fact, to attend class. A girl should not be forced to marry so young that her body is not ready for reproduction. But too many are engaged to be married when they, in fact, should be learning to read. Adolescent girls should never be a battleground in war. But we know that in conflicts, girls are raped with the intention of humiliating, demoralizing, and breaking the whole community. It's become a weapon of war. The girls who are subject to poverty, to early marriage, to female genital mutilation, abuse, and other violations hold a great potential for progress in their home countries and in the world. Studies show, and this is very important, I find, that the longer girls stay in school, the more they earn, the smaller the families they choose to have, the better not only their own lives will be, but also society as a whole. Each year of secondary schooling has proved to increase girls' future wages by up to 20%. It shows the relationship also between the goals, education, poverty. When women and girls earn income, they reinvest almost an unbelievable figure, according to these studies, 90% of it into their families' lives. That is two or three times as much as men do, I admit. The United Nations has had a mandate for United Nations has had a mandate for gender equality since the day we were founded. The opening lines of our charter in the preamble that you probably read every night, I would hope. those lines commit us to, and I quote, to the equal rights of men and women, written in the preambular part of the UN Charter. And now we have a new monumental push for equality with the 2030 agenda, for Sustainable Development. I really picked up two formulations from my distinguished friends and colleagues on the podium. I liked very much what you said, Babatunde, that these girls, they are the SDG generation. Mm-hmm. We have responsibility for the SDG generation. And I would say they are not only people we should help, and that whom we should work for, we should also work with them. They should not be only objects, they should be subjects. We should bring in the dynamics of their own dreams and aspirations. And that's why the SDG generation word is so good, because they're also a vehicle for the implementation of the goals. And then Mogens Lykketoft's words about going as far as to calling this agenda almost revolutionary. It is correct. I remember when I started this process, four years ago, I said to myself, I wonder if the member states will keep that high level of ambition. And they did. They did. They never backed down. I thought this could be a negotiation of coming down to lowest common denominators, as often is the case. But no. So we have the most ambitious, the most revolutionary instrument in our hand, which we really have to use these next 15 years. That's why it's so important that these goals are now translated to national realities, national planning, and particularly dealing with the most vulnerable, the most furthest behind, as we say. The SDGs commit us to give all girls all the opportunities they deserve on their path to adulthood. The goals aim to ensure access to sexual and reproductive health information and services. This helps avoid unwanted pregnancy and stop the spread of sexually transmitted diseases. Under the SDGs, females are to be spared genital mutilation that causes so much lasting damage. Girls must also be protected from other harmful traditional practices. The goals call for high-quality education for girls. They should also have a voice in decisions that affect them and their lives, as I said earlier. When we achieve progress for girls, we will see advances across all of society, as statistics and studies have proven. That's why this is more than an issue for women. It's a challenge for humanity. Here I would like to say that it's extremely encouraging that so many men now have taken up this cause. The He for She campaign has brought millions of men and boys into our campaign for gender equality, and I really commend Fumzile and her colleagues for their active work on this. I will strain your patience one more time. My speechwriters get very nervous. But I worked for a prime minister in Sweden. His name was Olof Palme. And once he received a draft speech with, as he thought, rather boring title, or not very visionary title. It was The Importance of the Emancipation of Women. So he looked at the title, he looked at the colleagues in the room, and I was one of them. I wasn't a speechwriter, though. And he said, "You haven't understood. You have not understood. First of all, this is a boring title. But secondly, it's not a question of emancipation of women. It's a question of emancipation of man." That's great foresight, isn't it? I also think it's good that UNFPA, and under Babatunde's leadership, and UNICEF with Tony Lake have just launched a global program to accelerate action to end child marriage. And their joint program on female genital mutilation, I come back to that, has helped push communities which are home to 12 million people to abandon the practice. The Secretary General's UNITE campaign is mobilizing millions of people to end the pandemic of violence against women and girls. And now countries are rallying around the SDGs to realize a life of dignity for all, in particular all the world's women and girls. So in closing, ladies and gentlemen and colleagues and friends, let me tell you just briefly about a young woman in Haiti who works as a mechanic. When she chose her career, many people told her that she as a woman was not up to the job as a mechanic. But she persisted. She knew women could do any job a man could. Finally, she was able to get a job repairing buses, which she did very well. She simply said, when I find problems, I try to find solutions. And I guess that goes for both the job market or fixing a bus which needed repair. We know enough about the problems facing the world's adolescent girls. Let us take our inspiration from the many women and girl heroes among them and find solutions. When we do, we will see progress in bringing together the imperatives of peace, development, and human rights. Peace, development, human rights. This work is related to all three of these major pillars of the United Nations. And our adolescent girls can help lead the charge together with all of us to a new future. Thank you very much.
Let me thank the Deputy Secretary General for a very inspiring speech. And now I wish to invite Mrs. Fumzile Lagunguka, the Executive Director of UN Women, for her remarks. Fumzile.
Thank you very much. I'd like to start by also thanking UNFPA for this opportunity and event. President of the General Assembly, President Lykketoft, Mr. Deputy Secretary General Jan Ellenson, Dr. Babatunde Ositemehin, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here this morning. In 2015, member states committed to accelerated action for a more just, more peaceful, and more equal world. The realization of our 2030 agenda, a world where no one is left behind, will depend on the engagement of youth as agents of change and on girls in particular. We need to invest in this vision, and we need to do it now for the reasons that have also already been mentioned. Because unfortunately, gender inequality is a significant barrier to progress. Young women and girls are one of the largest groups that are affected by poverty, by malnutrition, certainly by violence, exclusion from education, and poor health outcomes. A fourth of humanity is now aged between 10 to 24 years old. The vast majority live in the developing world, according to the United Nations Population Fund. Two of five young people globally are either unemployed or working in such ill-paid jobs that they cannot escape poverty, even if they work very hard. Quality education prepares girls for employment and decent work in all sectors. It empowers them to have control over their own lives and bodies and propels them into the decision-making and political spheres, only if the world, in a way, also supports emancipation and gender equality. Still, many girls are denied access or forced to drop out of school, to work, and to look after family members. We know that girls are not as engaged as boys in science, technology, engineering, and maths subjects. Right now, fewer than 70% of the computer science degrees go to female students. This has economic impact, as an estimated 90% of future jobs will require ICT skills. Education is a powerful lever for preventing violence against women and girls by prompting respectful relationship and gender equality amongst young boys and girls. Adolescent girls must have access to quality sex education and sexual and reproductive health services to give young women autonomy over their bodies and prevent early pregnancies. Complications from pregnancies and deliveries are one of the leading causes of death for girls aged between 15 and 19. Girls who have been subjected to FGM are especially prone to birth complications. Every day, more women and girls are being infected by the Zika virus. Addressing the needs of adolescent girls and young women is essential in the effort to protect young women from potential harm associated with Zika virus infection, especially in the regions where teenage pregnancy rates are high and women and girls' reproductive care options are limited and unplanned pregnancy is highly prevalent. Worldwide, more than 700 million women alive today were married as children. These child brides often experience sexual violence, are denied sexual and reproductive autonomy and rights, and are vulnerable to early pregnancies, as well as sexually transmitted infections, including HIV and AIDS. To achieve Planet 50-50 by 2030, we are partnering with young women and their organization, as well as with young men. We work with a girl guiding movement in 30 countries through a unique non-formal education program to prevent violence against women for youth between the ages of 5 and 25. The Voices Against Violence program will reach 800,000 children and young people by next year. I've just seen some of them this morning. We will also continue to engage girls, boys, and youth to become agents of change through our signature campaigns, including He for She, Unite, and the Safe Cities Initiative. UN Women is calling for all countries to repeal discriminatory laws that create barriers for adolescent girls in education, access to healthcare, and decent jobs and equal pay. Investments in infrastructure so that girls do not have to miss school fetching drinking water or firewood, or for personal hygiene needs that are not met in the schools themselves. Schools must teach STEM subjects to girls so that girls will be in a stronger position to compete in a job market. And when girls are in a stronger position to compete in the job market, the whole community, society, and our world benefits. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fumzile. And I would like to, because we are often accused of not engaging with young people, and they tell us that we should not do anything for them without them. So we are very pleased to have with us today a young lady from Ghana. I was in Ghana about 3 weeks ago, and they organized one of the most vibrant meetings that I've attended on sexual health in Africa. And they have a good name. It's called Curious Minds. Dr. Grace Gemma Boateng is here, representing Curious Minds, and she would give us a statement. Grace.
Thank you very much. His Excellency Lykketoft, President of the 70th session of the General Assembly, His Excellency Mr. Eliasson, Deputy General Secretary, Dr. Babatunde Osotimehin, Undersecretary General and Executive Director for UNFPA, Ms. Fumzile Mlambo Nguka, Undersecretary General and Executive Director of UN Women, ladies and gentlemen, let me first thank UNFPA and other organizers of this meeting for this opportunity. It means a lot to me, a young woman coming from sub-Saharan Africa. And it reflects the argument we make every day that our efforts will be better and our results will be stronger if we include women and girls, not just some of them, but all of them. We are gathered here today to address a very critical issue, an issue that cannot be taken out of the discussions of the Sustainable Development Goals. Investing in the adolescent girl to achieve the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. The 2030 Agenda offers a historic opportunity to change the lives of the world's adolescent girl. It includes ambitious indicators that will effectively measure the real impact of our policies, strategies, and practices to ensure that the most vulnerable and marginalized populations are part of our discussions. The good news about the SDGs is that it doesn't stop with only the gender goal. Girls are referenced 17 times across the agenda's 17 goals, with a grand total of 17 goals which are competing for funding. It will be up to advocates to ensure that adolescent girls get their share of the global resources. We've made significant strides in terms of investment in girls, educational reforms, healthcare access, equitable employment, peace and security. But the progress has been very slow and uneven. The statistics are always against those from developing countries and the rural poor. There still remain thousands of young girls who are married off before their 18th birthday. Thousands of young girls who are newly infected with HIV, which continues to hit adolescent girls harder than their male counterparts. Several who have to drop out of school because of childbirth and poverty. There are some who are products of violence and sexual exploitation and have no access to contraceptives, safe abortion services, and comprehensive sexuality education. Some have limited opportunities and undergo cultural practices that weigh them down, constrain their freedom, and in too many cases, doom them to a bleak future. I cannot end without telling you my story. An example of good results we get when we invest in young girls. I grew up in an environment which was predominated by boys, and where boys occupied most of the leadership positions whilst I was an adolescent girl. I kept asking myself, can a girl also be a class leader? Can a girl also be a president? Can a girl also be a school prefect? It seemed impossible because there were no examples around. But now when we look around, we can point out so many examples. This is a step in the right direction. As an adolescent girl, I wanted to define all odds and make the case that girls can also make it when given the opportunity. In junior high school, I was very timid and I will not utter a word in class. I will always occupy the back seat in class because society had taught me that the girl's role was at the backstage. It was until I joined Curious Minds, a youth rights advocacy group based in Ghana, when my perspective was changed. At this point, let me also commend UN Women for the He for She campaign. The producer for Curious Minds is a man, and he is the one who saw a potential that many did not see in me and spurred me on to great heights. These are the words of the producer when I told him that I was coming to speak here today. He says, "She was shy. I knew it. I had worked on people like that earlier and knew this is another successful project in the making. A little interaction showed that this is a volcano awaiting to explode." She tried to run away from her first assignment to recite a simple poem at one of our Curious Minds functions. I was not ready to yield, so she rehearsed and the delivery came with the necessary emotions. The poem, my landlord, launched her, and since then it was progress to tell others that there is another lady who is going to make a case for several other ladies. I increased her task from featuring as a member in our mock parliament to being a strong presenter on our weekly child rights radio show. There was a big turning point. We had to elect a new young president for the group. I had made my intentions clear it was going to be a girl. Some of the members laughed off my points and asked how, but it happened. By the time we ended the elections, Grace had won. It was like the coordinator will always have his way, but it was because we were putting in place somebody capable, somebody going to make a strong case for other girls. I have never regretted giving that opportunity and supporting her. The progress is more than this whole session will allow. But in epitome, it strengthens the point that girls and ladies are capable. In conclusion, let us provide an equal platform, a platform that gives weight to equity, and we all benefit. Only if the world will recognize that there are more waiting in the wings to prove a point, we will be nearing the Agenda 2030 much earlier than the proposed date. Adolescent girls need empowerment and an environment that guarantees their rights. I am a medical doctor today because I had an enabling environment to help me develop. Sadly, this is not the case for millions of other adolescent girls, and we need to change that. Let us rise up for the adolescent girl today. No more time to waste. Now is the time for action. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Grace. And I want to also say that I'm parochial because she's a physician and I'm a physician. And I think going through med school and being a physician actually gives you added advantage in terms of confidence and all. But certainly, she comes across as a great advocate for women and adolescent girls. And as the DSG was just whispering to me, I think we need to have her speak to adolescent boys because some of them are in trouble and they require the kind of confidence you put across. I think we need to balance it because when I speak about adolescent girls, people accuse me of not talking about the boys. So we have to keep going and making sure that boys and girls have the same opportunities. And I just want to say that a couple of things which I heard, which I believe we should highlight. The issue of HIV in adolescent girls is a major issue. You know, today, the incidence of HIV is highest in adolescent girls in the world. And so we have to do something about that. There is the high level on HIV that is coming up, and I think we need to address that at that point. But I'm not fazed, and Grace, I want you to also know that there are countries in the world that are taking this forward. Rwanda has more than 60% of its parliament as women. And the new Canadian cabinet is 50% of women. So I think we're moving in the right direction, and I believe that that's where to go. So we'll come to the end of the opening session. Let me take the opportunity on behalf of our co-sponsors, UN Women and UNICEF, to actually do thank most graciously the President of the General Assembly and the DSG for giving us the opportunity to participate and for your inspiring comments at this opening ceremony. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let me now welcome you to the panel discussion, which follows on in the high-level forum on adolescent girls and the Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development. The interactive panel has the following people: His Excellency Mr. Gustavo Velasquez, the permanent representative of Peru; Ms. Mutale, the permanent secretary, Ministry of Gender of the Republic of Zambia; Ms. Zamaniego, the elite network of young people for sexual and reproductive health and rights; and Ms. Siva, who is actually almost a member of staff of UNFPA, executive director, the Asia Pacific Resource and Research Center for Women Arrow. And we have the deputy executive director of UNICEF, who is going to join us in a minute, and then Ms. Maria Jose Ostergaard, the president, Zonta International and Zonta International Foundation. I hope I have been able to discharge the responsibilities appropriately. Now, this session is to further deep dive on the issues of adolescents and adolescent girls, particularly those who are growing up in the developing world, and what we have to do, especially with investment in education, health, skills development, and how to make them appropriate for the 21st century. And as I look at it and examine what these issues are, I think it speaks to the 17 goals of the SDGs and how we need to implement all of those together in terms of putting the adolescent girls at the center of this implementation. So let me just go right ahead with the distinguished panelists who have shown leadership in various aspects of this, investing in education, health, empowerment of girls. And I would introduce them one after the other, and we give them 5 minutes each to make an opening statement, and then we'll get to the next phase of the session. Let me start with Ambassador Gustavo. As I said, he's the permanent representative of Peru to the United Nations. He's a career diplomat with over 30 years of service in the Peru Foreign Service, and he has held various positions in the Foreign Ministry, including National Director of Sovereignty and Boundaries from June 2008 to July 2009, and the rank of Minister and Director of the World Trade Organization Affairs and head of the Peruvian delegation in the negotiations for an association agreement with the European Union from 2007 to 2008. And we know that he brings to this a wealth of experience and gravitas to contribute robustly to this conversation. Your Excellency, you have the floor.
Muchas gracias, doctor Babatunde Osotit Menin, director del Ejecutivo del Fondo de Población de las Naciones Unidas, distinguidas panelistas, estimados y estimadas asistentes. Quiero transmitirles en primer lugar el saludo del Gobierno del Perú, del Presidente de la República, Ollanta Humala, y de la Ministra de la Mujer y Poblaciones Vulnerables, Marcela Guaita, quien hoy lamentablemente no ha podido acompañarnos. El Estado peruano comparte la importancia de resaltar la inversión en las niñas, niños y adolescentes como una prioridad en la agenda del desarrollo sostenible, pues permitirá alcanzar las diferentes metas que tenemos para los campos del desarrollo económico, social y ambiental. Nuestro país atraviesa un periodo de transición demográfica caracterizado por importantes transformaciones en la estructura de nuestra población. De acuerdo con las estimaciones, el Perú está en una etapa de bono demográfico que habría comenzado en el año 2005 y se extendería al menos por 42 años, aproximadamente hasta el 2047, con lo que tenemos uno de los periodos de bono demográfico más prolongados de la región. Esto es innegablemente una oportunidad para el desarrollo por la máxima expansión de nuestra población productiva, mientras que nuestra población infantil viene disminuyendo como consecuencia del descenso de la fecundidad y nuestra población adulta mayor permanece en niveles bajos. Estamos en un momento histórico para la mejora económica y social sin precedentes, lo que nos coloca en un escenario propicio para avanzar en la agenda de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible 2030, en el que podamos fortalecer nuestro sistema de salud, seguridad social, a fin de empoderar en todos los niveles a las niñas, niños y adolescentes que son el presente y el futuro del Perú. Hoy es importante poder compartir una revisión de algunas de las políticas y programas que el Perú ha adoptado y que han permitido la disminución de brechas de géneros en los tres campos de este panel. Primero, educación para todas las niñas. A la fecha, el Perú ha concretado importantes avances en el cierre de brechas de género, tanto en inicial, primaria y secundaria, lo que se expresa en que en los tres niveles las mujeres igualan o superan a los hombres en el indicador de acceso educativo desde hace varios años. Nuestro reto es cerrar las brechas intragénero, que no permiten especialmente a los adolescentes rurales igualar los niveles alcanzados en las zonas urbanas del país. Las decisiones de política adoptadas en los últimos años nos ponen en la perspectiva correcta para alcanzar el objetivo 4 de garantizar una educación inclusiva y equitativa de calidad y promover oportunidades de aprendizaje permanente para todos y todas, sin disparidades de género. Al 2030 nos enrumbamos a que las niñas y todos los niños tengan acceso a servicios de atención y desarrollo en la primera infancia, educación preescolar de calidad, que todas las niñas y todos los niños terminen la enseñanza primaria y secundaria y que haya acceso igualitario de todos los hombres y las mujeres a una formación técnica, profesional y superior de calidad. Deseo resaltar tres campos en los que la acción estatal se ha concentrado. Y primero, incremento sustantivo de la inversión. La educación ha sido una prioridad en la política pública nacional desde hace varios años. El Perú ha iniciado una revolución en educación y por primera vez en la historia republicana, el Estado peruano ha logrado superar el 3% del Producto Bruto Interno de inversión en este campo. En el presupuesto público de 2016, este porcentaje alcanza el 4.1% y el reto para los próximos años es llegar al 6% del Producto Bruto Interno para educación. Estrategias en el área rural. En la política educativa en los últimos años se ha focalizado en estrategias de intervención en las áreas rurales. Se ha formado un incremento en el número de centros rurales de formación en alternancia, los cuales constituyen instituciones educativas públicas de gestión asociativa ubicadas en las zonas rurales y que tienen como objetivo promover el desarrollo local a través de la formación integral de adolescentes y jóvenes, así como reducir la deserción en la educación secundaria. Tercero, educación con perspectiva de inclusión social. El Perú ha reforzado la inclusión educativa con programas especializados para las niñas, niños y adolescentes en condiciones de pobreza extrema, a través de programas sociales como uno que se denomina Cuna Más para el cuidado y desarrollo de la primera infancia, otro que se denomina Jali Warma, que es un programa para desayunos escolares, y Beca 18 para el acceso a la educación superior en ciencia y tecnología y oportunidades de capacitación en el extranjero, auspiciadas por el gobierno del Perú. Estas medidas son consistentes con la agenda de medios de implementación de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible para este objetivo porque apuntan a contar con instalaciones educativas que tengan en cuenta las diferencias de género, que ofrezcan entornos de aprendizaje seguros, no violentos, inclusivos y eficaces. Se enrumban en la perspectiva de aumentar el número de becas para las poblaciones más desfavorecidas y mejorar la terminación efectiva de la escuela. En acceso a salud, el eje de salud para el Perú ha apostado también por importantes inversiones y por una reforma del sistema para encaminarse al aseguramiento universal de la población. En la agenda de los ODMs se logran avances importantes, aunque no totales, en el acceso a la salud de las mujeres. Pero existe un escenario institucional favorable para alcanzar el objetivo de desarrollo sostenible número 3 de garantizar una vida sana y promover el bienestar a todas las edades. Se ha obtenido avances en razón de la priorización de aspectos como la cobertura de servicios de salud. El acceso de las mujeres a los servicios de atención de salud ha mejorado notablemente, lo que se manifiesta en el incremento progresivo del porcentaje de mujeres peruanas cubiertas por el seguro de salud y la mejora de las cifras emblemáticas en este campo. Mejoras en los servicios de salud materna. Se han focalizado los servicios materno-neonatales para reducir la mortalidad materna y la mortalidad infantil. Por ejemplo, el parto institucional ha ido en aumento y cada vez más las mujeres acuden a los establecimientos de salud para ser atendidas en sus partos. Es un reto para el país profundizar la estrategia de atención especializada para adolescentes, con especial énfasis en prevenir el embarazo de este grupo de edad. Se ha apostado por implementar servicios de salud diferenciados para adolescentes que representan el 35.7% del total y cuentan con horarios diferenciados, con ambientes exclusivos, así como servicios diferenciados, especializados, servicios coordinados con instituciones educativas, servicios móviles para la atención integral y centros de desarrollo juvenil. Una acción a fortalecer es el programa Instituciones Educativas Saludables para el Desarrollo Sostenible del Ministerio de Salud, que capacita a nivel nacional a docentes de instituciones educativas, a padres de familia y a líderes escolares en temas de salud sexual integral y habilidades para la vida. Para el empoderamiento integral de las niñas y niños y adolescentes, se ha apostado por dos frentes de institucionalidad. Uno, desarrollo de servicios de promoción y defensa de los derechos de las niñas, niñas y adolescentes. El Perú, en el marco de un sistema de gobierno unitario, pero descentralizado, ha potenciado la articulación con los diferentes niveles de gobierno en ejes transversales, como la protección de los derechos de la infancia. En este marco se ha promovido la creación de una Defensoría Municipal del Niño, Niña y Adolescente. Esta instancia local promueve los derechos de la infancia a nivel comunitario y brinda atención gratuita mediante la conciliación en materia de régimen de visita, tenencia y aporte para alimentos que están directamente relacionados a los derechos de las niñas y niños en su entorno familiar. Política contra la violencia a niños, niñas y adolescentes. El Estado peruano ha llevado a cabo la Encuesta Nacional sobre Relaciones Sociales 2013-2015, la cual permite medir la prevalencia de la violencia intrafamiliar y sus factores causales, personales, familiares, socioculturales, en niños, niñas y adolescentes, y que aborda, en el caso de adolescentes, no solo violencia física o psicológica, sino también violencia sexual, esfuerzo conjunto del Ministerio de la Mujer y poblaciones vulnerables. Otro ejemplo es el estudio multinacional sobre los determinantes de la violencia hacia las niñas, niños y adolescentes, el que Perú forma parte y que es la base del diseño de estrategias de prevención a partir del análisis exhaustivo de los determinantes de la violencia. Estas medidas nos encaminan al cumplimiento de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible, en los que los derechos de la infancia son un eje transversal y también de metas específicas como las del Objetivo 16, que apunta a promover sociedades pacíficas e inclusivas para el desarrollo sostenible, que contempla como una de sus metas poner fin al maltrato, la explotación, la trata y todas las formas de violencia y tortura contra los niños y niñas. Siendo aún largo el horizonte a recorrer, el Estado peruano apunta a los ODS, apostando por aprovechar la oportunidad histórica que el bono demográfico nos brinda, buscando garantizar a nuestras niñas y niños y adolescentes de hoy un futuro de oportunidades para sus propias vidas y para el país. Muchas gracias.
Your Excellency, let me thank you for your intervention, which spoke to the concrete policy and program examples from Peru that have benefited adolescent girls. I think when we get to the discussion, maybe there will be questions that people would like to ask. Let me move quickly to Ms. Mutale, the Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Gender and Development, Republic of Zambia. And the overriding question for our intervention would be, what concrete policy and program examples from Zambia benefited adolescent girls? Ms. Tali.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And my fellow panelists, let me say all protocol observed. I'll start with setting the scenario in terms of providing a few statistics as far as our adolescents are concerned in Zambia. According to the Population Reference Bureau, young people in Zambia start having sex at a very young age, with 16% having sexual debut before the age of 15 and 60% before the age of 18. And that has got implications in terms of early marriages and being susceptible to HIV and AIDS. Teenage pregnancy between the 15 and 19 years age group, we have already started childbearing. We have about 27%, and nearly a third of girls aged 15, 19 have been pregnant or have had a child by then. Due to pregnancy, there's an increased number of school dropouts, which has reached almost 58%, as seen in the figures of 2012. Although the re-entry policy is in place, less than 40% of pregnant girls go back to school after childbirth. The Zambian government has put in place a policy where if a girl gets pregnant, she's allowed to get back in school after she's delivered. However, we're only seeing the 40% that I've alluded to. Due to child marriage, 31% of our girls are married off by 18 years, and often to spouses with multiple concurrent partners, which predisposes them to HIV risk. Adolescent girls and young women are disproportionately affected by HIV and AIDS, with a higher prevalence relative to male counterparts, which stands at 5.7% of girls compared to 4.2% of boys aged 15 and 19, and 11.7% of girls versus 5% of boys aged 20 to 24. The girls suffer more in terms of sexual and gender-based violence, with 40% of them during the first sexual experience, which is usually forced or unwanted, and they go on to suffer throughout their marriage time because they go into these marriages when they are young and they don't have self-esteem, neither do they have negotiating powers. In due course, you may ask the question, why adolescent girls? Why are we emphasizing on girls? Young people would face a large complex challenges, included limited opportunities to gain skills and confidence, barriers to education, and lack of sexual and reproductive health information and services. Given the global persistence of gender inequality, girls are disproportionately affected. It is estimated that more than half of new HIV infections are among young people, while between one quarter and one half of adolescent girls become mothers before they turn 18 years. Despite advances in recent years, girls continue to suffer severe disadvantages, discrimination, and exclusion, mainly for being young and being female. For many girls, puberty marks an accelerating trajectory into inequality. It also represents a critical window of preventive and protective investments that we must make if we are serious about achieving full gender equality. The inequalities faced by adolescent girls, which have significant consequences on social economic development, such as low literacy levels, poor health outcomes, and gender discrimination leading to limited opportunities to leverage economic activities and contribute to productive gains. When girls are able to choose when and whom to marry, when or whether to have children, and being free of violence, abuse, and exploitation, are free to define their lives and enjoy their rights, they not only enjoy better health, they are also better able to contribute to national development as economic actors and entrepreneurs, helping their countries reap a demographic dividend and driving economic growth. And suffice to say that with that grim picture that I painted over the adolescent situation of girls in Zambia, one would now want to know what is government doing about it. First, I must express my appreciation and gratitude to UNFPA, who've been constant partners in terms of supporting the Zambian government in coming up with programs that have to do with adolescents, especially in the sexual and reproductive health aspects. I'm happy to inform you of some key efforts by the current administration as government has prioritized the implementation of various policies and strategies which contribute to improving the development outcomes related to adolescent girls in our drive to achieve Zambia's aspiration of becoming an upper middle income country, Vision 2030. In order to address the high levels of child marriage, the government has launched a nationwide campaign to end marriage in 2013. I'm happy to note that this campaign has been widely supported by esteemed traditional leaders who have taken the role of agents of change in their communities. Further, the government has, with support from UNFPA and UNICEF, developed a multi-sectoral strategy of ending child marriages aimed at 30% reduction in child marriage by 2020. In the spirit of leaving no one behind and reaching the most marginalized, the government of Zambia, with support from UNFPA once more, has developed a national out-of-school comprehensive sexuality education program aimed at equipping young people who are out of school with the knowledge, skills, attitudes, and values they need to make informed decisions about their lives. Further, government recognizes that education is a powerful tool for emancipation of individuals and the nation at large, has through the Ministry of Education recently integrated comprehensive sexuality education in the national curriculum to be taught in all schools. In 2015, the Minister of Health collaborated with UNFPA to launch a mobile platform called Tune Me, a platform the adolescents can access through their mobile phones and empowers them with age-appropriate information about their sexual and reproductive health. The Minister of Education, on the other hand, is implementing school reentry policy, which provides additional school options and facilities for the return to school of learners who become pregnant and subsequently drop out of school. The government of Zambia, through my ministry, with support from UNFPA and UNICEF, has hosted the first ever African Girls Summit in November 2015. The summit, hosted under the auspices of African Union, drew participation from across Africa and resulted in a firm commitment from all participating governments and stakeholders to redouble efforts to eliminating child marriage no later than 2030. In order for investments in adolescent girls to be informed by evidence, the government has undertaken various assessments and analyses, including one on sexual reproductive health assessment, as well as other robust in-depth analyses on the issues of teenage pregnancy and adolescent girls, supported by UNFPA, UNICEF, and World Bank, to position the issues of adolescents and youths in the NDP and localized sustainable development goals. As a result of these studies, the World Bank is going to support a program under the Ministry of Gender, which will be looking at sending girls to school. Furthermore, the UN-led He for She campaign has been launched in six of the 10 provinces in Zambia, with 2,000 men signing up, committing themselves to ending GBV and supporting the female gender. A further 186 chiefs out of 288 traditional leaders have also signed up and are committed to the program. We also have 2,400 provincial heads of departments who have taken on the He for She campaign. Understanding the need to embrace integrated development planning and implementation, government through the Ministry of Finance undertook the demographic dividend study, which provides a set of policy and investment options which, once implemented, will enable the country to achieve economic prosperity as a result of prioritized education and health needs of young people. In conclusion, the success of 2013 agenda calls on all of us to leave no one behind, will be measured by how well we are collectively able to build a world in which girls have no limits on their aspirations of the future, no matter where they are born; B, a world where adolescent girls have access to sexual and reproductive health information and services and possess the knowledge and confidence they need to make the right choices for a health life; C, a world where every girl can enter freely into a productive adulthood because she's educated, healthy, free from sexually transmitted infections such as HIV, and not exposed to violence, unintended pregnancy, or unsafe abortion; D, a world where girls are treated with dignity and respect in equal measure with boys, and where, regardless of their sex, young people's human rights are promoted and respected. Going forward, we need to increase our efforts to end child marriage, adolescent pregnancy, female and other harmful practices affecting girls. We need to give girls unfettered access to comprehensive sexuality education, remove laws that impede their access to information, services, and choices, provide them with comprehensive health services, including contraceptive services, and most critically, keep them in school, whether they live in rural or urban areas, whether they are pregnant or not, whether they are married or single. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mutale, for sharing that rich experience from Zambia. Let me quickly move to Ms. Zamanego. From Mexico, what are the challenges girls face today, and what are the opportunities that girls seek for themselves? You speak from the work you do with Eligrec Red Black in Mexico.
Muchas gracias. Buenos días a todas y todos. Pues antes que nada, es un honor poder compartir algunas reflexiones que hemos desarrollado en América Latina y en México en particular. Y bueno, la necesidad de invertir en educación, empoderamiento y salud de las adolescentes parece ser un consenso entre todas las personas que estamos en esta sala, y eso es algo que celebro. Pero en esta ocasión me gustaría centrarnos en una reflexión, y es en los por qué. Cuando revisamos los argumentos centrales que convocan a mejorar las condiciones de niñas adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, encontramos que invertir en su educación es capacitarles para una vida productiva. Una adolescente sana y con oportunidades laborales se convertirá en una buena madre. Y digo, Es cierto, pero me gustaría que pudiéramos reflexionar un poco a partir de alguno de los análisis que ha hecho el feminismo. Y es que histórica y culturalmente, las mujeres hemos sido educadas en el ser para otras y para otros. Para obedecer a nuestro padre, para complacer a nuestra pareja, para desvivirnos por nuestros hijos e hijas. Y creo que no podemos seguir repitiendo esos patrones patriarcales. El mejorar las condiciones de niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes no puede ser el centro, el apoyo económico, el apoyo familiar, el ser buenas madres y el ser mujeres productivas. Actualmente en el mundo vemos algunas cifras que además de alarmarnos, deberían urgirnos a actuar. Como por ejemplo, un 11% de las niñas contraen matrimonio antes de cumplir 15 años, lo que compromete su derecho a la salud, a la educación y a un empleo digno. Casi el 50% de todos los casos de agresión sexual del mundo son contra niñas de menos de 15 años. Y 1 millón de niñas menores de 15 años dan a luz cada año con todas las complicaciones y complejidades que sabemos que eso significa. Estos datos son solamente una muestra de que niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes hemos sido excluidas y marginadas históricamente a partir de dos elementos centrales relativos con estructuras de poder, el género y la edad. Se nos ha negado el derecho a la educación, a la salud, a la autonomía, a tener el control sobre nuestro propio cuerpo y sexualidad. Se nos ha discriminado, violentado y asesinado por el simple hecho de ser mujeres. Y además de todo, somos cuestionadas constantemente sobre nuestra capacidad para poder tomar decisiones. Y esa es una línea que nos lleva a casarnos en contra de nuestra voluntad, a que se nos considere como máquinas de reproducción o se nos diga que tenemos que postergar la maternidad para potenciar nuestra productividad en aras del desarrollo. En suma, nuestros derechos han estado condicionados siempre a intereses ajenos. Hoy nos dicen que la educación y nuestra capacitación e integración al sistema económico es una prioridad porque contribuye al desarrollo de nuestras economías. Y si colocamos en el centro no el desarrollo en sí mismo, no los derechos humanos, sino el desarrollo de las economías, ese mismo argumento ha fomentado la precarización laboral, la migración forzada, la ocupación de países por sus recursos naturales, situaciones en las que claramente viven de manera muy compleja las niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes exponiéndose a violaciones sistemáticas de sus derechos humanos. El feminicidio es una prueba de ello. Además, es falso que no estemos integradas a la economía. Nuestra integración ha sido permanente. La diferencia es que las labores domésticas y de cuidado, el trabajo que hacemos en el ámbito privado, no es considerado productivo y por tanto no es remunerado. Entonces, existe sí, no solamente una división internacional y social del trabajo, sino una división sexual. Por esto, quiero comentar hoy y dejar en claro que la necesidad de invertir en niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes no debe estar basada en necesidades y en razones económicas, sino en dignidad y justicia. Entender esto es fundamental para avanzar hacia un verdadero desarrollo sostenible, porque si continuamos mirando el desarrollo como crecimiento económico, en lógicas de explotación económica, social y ambiental, no vamos a llegar a un 2030 para hablar de desarrollo sostenible. También es importante que para asegurar los derechos de niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, atendamos las condiciones estructurales. Esto es, que los estados garanticen los derechos sociales, económicos y políticos para que las mujeres puedan desarrollarse, para que desde la infancia podamos desarrollarnos. Colocando sí recursos en puesta de marcha de políticas públicas que estén focalizadas a las necesidades específicas de las adolescentes. La inversión debe materializarse en un acceso pleno a derechos como la educación, la salud, los derechos sexuales, la participación y la igualdad. En cuanto a la educación, constituye un proceso para dotar de conocimientos, aptitudes y confianza para enfrentar el día a día. Pero la educación no puede convertirse en una mera capacitación y en una mera en capacitar mano de obra que se centre en cuestiones ajenas a las niñas. Debe de centrarse en el desarrollo individual y colectivo y que debe contribuir a su emancipación y empoderamiento. En cuanto a la salud, es importante asegurar condiciones que garanticen a las niñas el nivel más alto de salud posible. Y eso supone, en primer lugar, el vivir libres de todo tipo de violencia. Sobre los derechos sexuales, los estados tienen que enfocar sus esfuerzos en asegurar las condiciones necesarias para que adolescentes y jóvenes podamos decidir libremente sobre nuestros cuerpos y vidas, que podamos ejercer plena y placenteramente nuestros derechos sexuales y reproductivos. En ese sentido, la educación integral en sexualidad no puede seguirse poniendo en duda. Es una herramienta para construir relaciones sociales diferentes, con aprecio y respeto a la diversidad, y que estén centradas en los derechos de todas las personas. En cuanto a la participación, la primera tarea es garantizar procesos de empoderamiento para niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, lo cual debe implicar también un cuestionamiento sobre las formas en que ejercemos el poder, para no continuar reproduciendo patrones culturales patriarcales de opresión. Así como también continuar con acciones necesarias, acciones afirmativas, en las que las mujeres podamos asumir posiciones de liderazgo en espacios políticos y sociales en situación de igualdad. La inversión tiene que materializarse en igualdad, y esto implica, como condición indispensable, un cambio de paradigma, dejar de reproducir la violencia y construir sociedades que reconozcan a las mujeres, niñas y adolescentes como personas con derechos plenos. Es importante colocarlo así porque aunque el fin sea el mismo, aunque el centro sea invertir en salud, educación y empoderamiento de las adolescentes, la manera en que se aborda va a ser una diferencia sustancial entre meros resultados estadísticos y verdaderas transformaciones. Y hablando de estadísticas, un antipoeta chileno decía: si tenemos dos panes, tú te comes dos y yo ninguno, en promedio comimos uno cada uno. Y esto quiere decir y habla sobre las brechas de incumplimiento. Sabemos que estas brechas de incumplimiento recaen en las poblaciones marginadas. Y en esas brechas se pone de manifiesto todas las discriminaciones y exclusiones. La Agenda 2030 reconoce que las mujeres, en especial las niñas y adolescentes, somos claves para el desarrollo. Y dice: no es posible realizar todo el potencial humano y alcanzar el desarrollo sostenible si se sigue negando a la mitad de la humanidad el pleno disfrute de sus derechos y oportunidades. Y eso suena maravilloso. Pero no queremos solamente acuerdos políticamente correctos. Queremos avanzar en ese reconocimiento, en garantizar los derechos de esas niñas, mujeres y adolescentes. Y es por tanto que estaremos atentas a los indicadores que complementen la Agenda 2030. Y es en el marco de la Agenda 2030 y de cara a la cuarta conferencia global Women Deliver, que se vislumbra como la reunión más grande sobre derechos y salud de las niñas y adolescentes, en donde se hablará también de los ODS, que llamamos a consolidar un pacto. Un pacto por la salud, los derechos y el empoderamiento de niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, que incorpore compromisos factibles a mediano plazo que podamos acompañar y dar seguimiento en al menos 5 ámbitos estratégicos: inversión y cooperación, transformación social y cultural, empoderamiento y participación, promoción de derechos y políticas públicas. Estaremos presentando esta iniciativa de pacto en Copenhague y esperamos que se puedan sumar. Nuestro objetivo debe ser que cuando hablemos de desarrollo, hablemos de personas, hablemos de mujeres libres, autónomas, felices, soberanas y plenas, y que esto no sea el privilegio de unas cuantas. Porque mientras haya mujeres oprimidas, ninguna otra, ninguna sociedad puede decirse liberada. Invertir en mujeres no es una cuestión de mero desarrollo económico, es una cuestión de igualdad y de derechos. Y como niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, vamos a seguir luchando hasta que la justicia y la dignidad gobiernen nuestros pueblos. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Maria. Now, I'm going to call on Siva to give us what additional steps does the international community need to take in order to make a difference in girls' lives. Siva.
So, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to be on this panel today. Globally, adolescents aged 10 to 19 comprise 18% of the population, and more than half of the world's 1.2 billion adolescents live in one region of the world, and that would be the Asia-Pacific region. Just four countries in the region, India, China, Indonesia, and Pakistan, have a combined adolescent population of 500 million. And so it is interesting to look that this large group of a demographic that is usually considered vulnerable and marginalized in so many processes lives in a continent which, though it has experienced rapid economic development, this rapid development has also caused great inequalities between countries and within countries. And surprisingly enough, we also come from political systems which suddenly today many countries are hearkening back to cultural, traditional, and religious values over human rights values. So I'd like to posit a picture amidst such economic inequality and in an environment ruled by political conservatism that the greatest burden falls unequally on marginalized and vulnerable populations such as adolescents, especially girls in our countries. A case which illustrates this is actually to add to like what Dr. Babatunde, you were saying, that a report that emerged at the end of last year from UNAIDS and UNICEF, and I do believe also UNFPA was part of this, is how adolescents are at most at risk for HIV in our region. And with 220,000 adolescents were estimated to be living with HIV in Asia and the Pacific. This is a result of the inability of countries in our region to make the paradigm shift to provide comprehensive sexuality education for those in school and out of school, provide access to services for safe sex and pregnancy prevention. And the inability of adolescents, because of their vulnerabilities and marginalizations, to access ART as compared to adults, we can also see that the highest number of deaths from AIDS and AIDS-related causes are actually falling in this very young age group. So what are kind of some steps we'd like to recommend? I think that one of the things we need to do is we need to move away from our traditional framing of young people, and three approaches are vital. One, we need to view adolescents, especially girls, with the lens of non-discrimination and autonomy. Adolescent girls are one group which will face their entire sexual and reproductive health life cycle ahead of them. Nowadays, what we see is people will say, well, the one thing you need to do is this. But it is not possible because we are talking about a group who has their entire life ahead of them. We have talked about youth-friendly services for a long time, but there still needs to be a transformation of attitudes. Studies in Kenya, Lao PDR, and China show that health providers believe that distributing information and contraceptives to young people encourages promiscuity. Young women are more affected by double standards on sexual behavior and face repercussions as these from society and from service providers. In this context of fulfilling rights, we should also be able to advocate for and argue for privacy and confidentiality from an agency perspective and to do away with parental and spousal consent for accessing SRH services. Hence, viewing young girls and young women as autonomous beings with the right to make decisions about their lives and choices about their lives and ensuring there is no non-discrimination. There is non-discrimination will enable us to transform access to services, but also transform traditional attitudes and societal perceptions of girls and young women. Now, the second approach which is also vital, is for us to look at the intersectional approaches when dealing with adolescents and girls. When we talk about goals and targets, we very often forget that human beings' lives and circumstances cannot be fitted into these silos of goals and targets. And it is impossible to link some of these targets and indicators to tell, and it is not impossible to link some of these targets and indicators to tell a story of development, rights, and SRHR of girls. Many young women and girls in our part of the region are beset either in context, are living in contexts beset by conflict and climate change. For girls, especially in many of the countries in my region, lesser household resources are set aside for girls. Girls eat last, eat less, and eat less nutritious food. Girls often have to help out with carrying water for their families or fetching firewood, often long and arduous tasks. The poverty of women and girls is something we don't talk about, but is essential if we want to make a real difference. For example, a female child may be born with low birth weight because their mothers were malnourished. She may grow up deprived of adequate nutrition to become an undernourished and stunted woman, and living in low-quality shelters that exposes her to multiple infections. She would have limited opportunities for adequate educational attainment and may be employed in backbreaking and hazardous occupations. She may be exposed to risk of sexual debut and sexual violence before her teenage years, marry or cohabit early, and give birth as a teenager facing associated risks of death and disability. She will have limited ability to control her sexual and reproductive life and have little or no access to quality healthcare services. Is this something that exists only in theory? This is actually the story of Chan, who is 23 years old and already has 6 children. So her childbearing years began in her adolescent years. This is not uncommon for women in rural Laos, where there is little access to SRHR services, information, and access to contraception. Her already vulnerable situation and heavy responsibility of looking after 6 children was worsened by a destructive drought that damaged agriculture and livestock a few years ago. She was forced to walk almost 20 kilometers every day to a water source and forest where there was food to forage so that she could keep her family alive. So if we want to make a real difference in the lives of girls and young women like Chan, we need to be able to connect the targets across different goals and be able to write a possible trajectory by which these people can escape the current situations that they are in. And this will make the difference for girls in our part of the world. The third and last approach I would advocate for is utilizing the values we derive from human rights. When we talk of human rights, we must realize all of us who are called to work with adolescents and young people have a duty and obligation, because indeed we are all duty bearers to young people, to recognize, promote, protect, and fulfill their rights. In this context of fulfilling the human rights of young people, this would entail obligations to end early marriage and end FGM, end violence against adolescents and young people, especially sexual violence. Another story that we have in the work that we have done, it comes from Bangladesh, where we work, and Sumitra's village was affected by Cyclone Sidr in 2007 and Flood Ayla in 2009. Her community is heavily dependent on fishing as both a source of food and income, and these would affect it drastically. This led to further impoverishment of families and communities, and the family started marrying girls off early, a practice that parents think and adopt during difficult times as they hope it will safeguard their daughters' futures. Sumitra had the same similar fate. And as she got married early, she got pregnant soon after her marriage and was unable to access proper food or medical care because her village was cut off during one of the many climate disasters, and she subsequently miscarried. So calling for these three approaches, you know, recognizing the autonomy of girls, looking at intersectionality and human rights values, is not going to be an easy task. And we have to ask whether we are prepared to take up this challenge. This would require us to address sociocultural religious norms in our society, change laws, or rather enforce laws, which may be difficult, especially in countries where there is a strong conservative force in our legislature. It may also force us to take an approach where different ministries have to work together in order to actually make an improvement in the lives of adolescents. But this, indeed, this is something we would need to do, because a human rights approach is not only about providing youth-friendly services to avoid pregnancy and HIV, but also to enable choices on who to marry, when to marry, and if at all in our society. It is about enabling a life free from all forms of violence, including traditional and cultural practices. It is about ensuring adolescent girls are able to enjoy better opportunities than their mothers did. When we can do the best for the least, that is, the most marginalized and the most vulnerable amongst us, then we can truly say we are a developed society and that we have achieved this Agenda 2030. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Siva. Can I now call on Maria Jose Ostergaard? Of the Zonta International Foundation, and to speak to how you see the private sector and foundations contribute to the well-being of adolescent girls.
Thank you. May I have the presentation, please? Oh, there you go. Thank you so much. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, when I was preparing for this trip, I asked my daughter, age 21, what she thought was the best of living in Denmark. It took her 2 seconds to answer, responsible freedom. She explained to me that in Denmark, boys and girls, they learned about health, equal rights, and the society. But the most important is that they think, they learn to think about the consequences of their actions. Freedom and responsibility, they are together. They're the two sides of the same circle. And as the boys and girls grow, their freedom grows, and with it, the responsibility for the actions they take. Freedom and responsibility, responsible freedom. We all know that, unfortunately, this is not the situation in many parts of the world, and especially for girls, when they grow, their freedom and their responsibility to take life, their life in their own hands decreases and is many very, very small. Here is where education plays a major role. With a return of investment of $10 to $15 for every dollar invested, education is the single best investment countries can make, building prosperous, healthy, and equitable societies. But this is just education. Absolutely not. Equal access requires laws and policies that guarantee that all boys and girls have access to school regardless of their marital or parental status. Non-discriminatory education means that girls should have access to all resources on equal basis with boys, and that no one tells them, oh, you're a girl, then you're not good at maths or science. The most important is to have a human rights approach to the education. That means that boys and girls, they are respected equally based on their qualifications. And I think gender is not a qualification here. So you might ask, what does the civil society, what does Zonta and Zonta International Foundation do? Zonta International seeks to empower girls and women worldwide by improving the legal, political, economical, educational, health, and professional status of women at the global and local levels through service and advocacy. This biennium, you are focusing on the prevention of root causes of gender inequality and violence against women through education. We support projects in cooperation with UN agencies, projects that have service and advocacy sites, but also educational aspects that help women and girls to understand their rights, to understand that women's rights are human rights, and to become self-sufficient. We also have our educational programs, our own projects and programs, the Young Women in Public Affairs Awards, that recognizes young women for demonstrated leadership skills and commitment to service, to public service and civic causes, and encourages them to continue their participation in public and political life. The Jenim Klossmann Women in Business Scholarship helps women pursue undergraduate and master degrees in business management and overcome gender barriers from the classroom to the boardroom. And finally, the Amelia Earhart Fellowship helps talented women pursuing advanced studies in the typically male-dominated fields of aerospace-related science and aerospace-related engineering achieve their educational goals. Those educational programs are supported in the 67 countries where SONTA is represented, where local awardees, scholars, and fellows are identified, rewarded, and supported. With the generosity and collective actions of SONTians and friends around the world, SONTA International has supported projects in 57 countries, provided scholarships and awards to women around the world globe, and been a powerful advocate for change in our local and international communities, thereby transforming the world and women's place in it. Let me finalize by mentioning two of the projects this biennium. I could talk about all of them forever, but the first one is the delay in early marriage in Niger and the school pilot project in Vienna and after that. Early marriage is one of the most important root causes for inequality and violence against women. Not only because girls lose their opportunities to have an education and thus becoming financially independent. From the health point of view, girls younger than 15 are 5 times more likely to die in childbirth than women in their 20s. Pregnancy is the leading cause of death worldwide for girls aged 15 to 19. And child brides face a high risk of contracting HIV, as it has been mentioned, because they often marry an older man with more sexual experience. SONTA is very proud to partner with UNFPA in this project, through which 25,000 adolescent girls will be reached over 2 years, with 400,000 members of their community benefiting from increased awareness. The adolescents will develop health, social, and economic assets. They will know their rights and be in a stronger position to defend them, be safer, and have a measure of protection against violence. The gender-responsive school pilot project in Vietnam runs in partnership with UN Trust Fund and has the main objective to create a school environment for adolescent girls and boys across Hanoi that is free from gender-based violence. Plan Vietnam, a UN Trust Fund grantee, is promoting a model of safe, accountable, and child-friendly schools where adolescent girls and boys receive quality education in an environment free of violence. The purpose is to train the ambassadors, the young generation, the boys and the girls, to organize school campaigns and assist teachers. Then to train the teachers and empower them to prevent violence and inform and engage the parents and caregivers. The new generation is the one taking ownership of defining what is equal rights, how the school should be. Only by taking ownership, we can be sure that the changes will be sustainable. Altogether, in SONTA, we believe we support projects and programs that matter, initiatives that transform the lives of many young women and girls worldwide. We, the members of SONTA International, and the SONTA International Foundation know that our financial support is crucial for achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. And we're proud of our partnership with the UN agencies. But the most important is not the money. The most important is when we know that we give women and girls worldwide the help they need so they become self-sufficient, they can take ownership of their own lives, and they can contribute to the sustainable change themselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mary Rose. And I think that also gives us the flavor that Agenda 2030 is about everybody, and it brings everybody, foundations, private sector, the public sector, and UN organizations and everybody into the fray of trying to make sure that we work together in achieving the objective of Agenda 2030. Now, I will now move quickly to ask the Deputy Executive Director of UNICEF, Rao Gupta, to give us a flavor of what, in fact, everybody said, before we get into the conversations.
Thank you so much, Dr. Babatunde. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. You've heard very eloquent presentations from our distinguished panelists, and each of them has made the point that adolescence is a specially critical period of risk and vulnerability for girls because of the very particular ways in which gender and age intersect to create disadvantage, inequalities, and in some cases, discrimination. It's an inequality that begins early in life for girls, but it multiplies during the adolescent years as sexuality comes into play. It is because of that that this period of life is marked by multiple life transitions in many ways that boys don't experience. This is particular to girls because this is the period during which girls in many societies are likely to get married far too young, get pregnant, and experience motherhood, catapulting them into adulthood way before they are ready for it. That is what you heard from many of the panelists puts adolescent girls at particular risk. But what we don't talk about enough is that the second decade of life and this period of adolescence provides a period of opportunity as well. It's an opportunity in terms of brain development because we have now learned from neurologists that it's a second chance to catch up in brain development if the early years didn't provide enough nourishment. It's also a stage of life that's malleable, where you can shape attitudes and behaviors, because that's when they get crystallized. So to build on the concept of responsible freedom, if that's what we are aiming for, how do we shape that? How do we make that happen by involving our adolescents in understanding the value of responsibility and the value of freedom? But to do that, they need appropriate access to key resources. And we talked about, many of you talked about those, to education and information, sex education in particular, but just a formal education with equal opportunity to learn about mathematics and the sciences for girls as the other subjects as well. Safety from violence, good nutrition, access to contraception, and to many other health services. If they can get access to those particular resources, there's greater likelihood that the trajectory that they are on will stay on track. Because once they go off track during this period of life, it's very difficult to get them back on track. So early marriage, pregnancy gets girls off track, and then it's very difficult to reverse that. We also heard that all girls deserve access to these resources, deserve the ability to be able to maximize their potential during these years, because they have a right to that, but also because if we don't do that, the loss is borne by all of society, because we lose their economic potential. The points that I wanted to make to contribute to this discussion is that in response to this understanding that we've had for many decades now about the importance of this period for girls, we have come up with many kinds of interventions, but have often implemented them at a very small scale. They've often been pilot interventions done in communities as boutique projects. But it's now time to think of scale. How do we scale this up? There are over 600 million adolescent girls worldwide, so we need to think about that size and that potential and scope in order to move forward and take advantage of the opportunities that the Sustainable Development Goals has given us by placing this period of life very much central to the achievement of those goals. So this is not just about scaling up small programs, but thinking much bigger at a systems level, stepping outside of our comfort zone to come up with innovative new solutions and forging new alliances that can give us that scale. We did hear some of those examples this morning of how governments are acting at scale to provide those resources. But we need to do that within each sector. Often, in many countries, you have a gender equality plan that sits outside the health plan, the education plan, the water and sanitation plan. How do we integrate the response to inequalities, not just within health, education, water and sanitation, but also within transportation, within infrastructure, within our plans, national plans for technology development, in media houses, so that we can deliver essential services and opportunities for girls. And in particular, to try and reach girls who are the most disadvantaged, who are the most vulnerable. At UNICEF, we are applying this principle to our own work. It's not easy because there are few existing models of how to do things in a bigger, better, and smarter way when programming for girls. But we're doing it through our gender action plan. And I'll give you just a few examples. In Nigeria, we're working with the government, with national and local leaders, and with communities in 5 states to get 1 million girls into school, keep them there, and make sure they learn. And how are we doing that? By really focusing on training female teachers, making sure that school management responds to girls' needs in over 600 schools. In India, to give you another example, UNICEF has been the government's partner of choice in the National Nutrition Supplementation Scheme to address what is a large problem in India, which is anemia among adolescent girls. Their anemia among rates among girls is almost twice as high as that among boys in India. This partnership has evolved over 13 years of demonstration programs and evidence building to now target over 65 million adolescent girls on iron and folic acid supplementation, working through 3 ministries, health, education, and women and child development. Boys are also included in the program. And so it's a program that's built with the understanding that anemia for both girls and boys is a bad thing, but it targets girls in particular because of the very high prevalence among girls. Sometimes to do it right, we need creativity. The creativity to see the potential of a platform to deliver meaningful results for adolescent girls. And I'm referring now particularly to the younger set of adolescents between the ages of 10 to 14. As part of the Gavi Alliance, the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, UNICEF, together with UNFPA, WHO, has been able to deliver HPV vaccine, the vaccine that prevents cervical cancer, to 9 to 13-year-old girls that as part of health services, because these girls otherwise are not on the radar of health systems. In countries like Zimbabwe and Bangladesh, we've been working with national partners to do adolescent health assessments as part of the HPV vaccine delivery to see whether other key interventions like puberty education, menstrual hygiene management can be delivered through the same platform. So that's the creative element there, is how do you use that platform to deliver more than one kind of service. And in Brazil and Bolivia now, we're exploring partnership with the private sector for financing such additional services. The SDGs offer us a very important vehicle to be able to achieve scale, and that is the number of new partnerships and alliances and frameworks that are emerging in response to this new set of goals. I'll just mention one that offers us a particular opportunity here within the UN in partnership with the private sector and governments and civil society organizations, and that's the Secretary General's Every Woman, Every Child new global strategy, which has been transformed to include not just to keep children and mothers alive, but also to help them thrive and to create the transformative enabling environments for them to be able to do so. What's exciting about that new strategy is that it not only includes reproductive, maternal, newborn, and child health, but for the first time includes adolescent health. I mention this because that strategy now has adolescents as a key focus, financing vehicles like the Global Financing Facility of the World Bank is also now emphasizing adolescence as a key period. All of this is just by way of examples. I look forward to the discussion. I will say that for any of this to work, it is very important to involve girls themselves, use their aspirations, their energy, their creativity to help shape a future where they are in charge of their own destinies. Thank you very much, Dr. Babatunde.
Thank you very much, Geeta. And I think we've now set the stage for what should be a robust conversation. And I think to bring back the focus to every woman, every child, every adolescent, everywhere. And I think that's really where we should be going. So I have before me some indication of those who I want to speak. Can I then just proceed to call on the distinguished delegate of Canada?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Canada is a long-standing advocate for gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls. Overwhelming evidence shows that they act as a multiplier on all other development goals, and that gender equality is critical to the achievement of peace, prosperity, and sustainable development. Adolescence, and we heard a lot this morning about that, is a critical period when many young women face challenges to realizing their rights. Their aspirations are constrained by limited access to quality education, healthcare, and economic opportunities. They face entrenched barriers such as sexual and gender-based violence and harmful practices such as child early and forced marriage. They also are facing negative social attitudes or cultural values which limit their potential and progression. And that was emphasized this morning by our distinguished delegates from Ghana, Mexico, Zambia, and Mrs. Tanen-Tiran a bit earlier. Investments in girls during this time in their lives, particularly for the poorest and most vulnerable, have transformative impacts on health, education, and economic outcome for themselves, their families, their communities, and their countries. And this was eloquently articulated this morning, Dr. Babatunde. You made a very strong point about this in your opening statement. Through military engagement, diplomacy, and programming, Canada works to advance the right of and empowerment of young women and adolescent girls. Education is critical for adolescent girls to be able to realize their potential, yet they face a number of barriers, including lack of access to education in remote and insecure areas, the need of separate toilets, water, soap, and other very simple things like sanitary products. Sexual and gender-based violence in and around schools, child early and forced marriage, and early pregnancy. Canada is providing targeted support to address these challenges and to integrate attention to gender equality issues into all education programming so that girls can access safe and quality education. Canada is also accelerating support for women's, children, and adolescent health through active engagement in Every Woman, Every Child. It was just reminded by our colleague Geeta from UNICEF, and the implementation of the Global Strategy for Women, Children, and now Adolescents' Health for 2016-2030. Canada's leadership in this area will be driven by evidence and outcomes, including closing gaps in reproductive rights and healthcare of women and adolescent girls. And in this regard, we are closely engaging in the ongoing discussions and negotiations for the adequate indicators for the SDGs. Canada is committed to ending child and forced marriage and all forms of violence against adolescents and girls. And we heard vivid examples this morning of a number of initiatives from countries, and we will continue to support those initiatives. Canada envisages a world where women and girls are valued and empowered, have control on their own lives, fully participate as decision makers in their homes and societies, and contribute to and benefit from development and prosperity, just as men and boys. Girls are powerful agents of change and need to be included as full participants in decisions that affect their lives and in the implementation of the 2030 Agenda. We need to ensure that they have the right tools and opportunities to make a difference. In closing, I would like to emphasize how much Canada values its partnership with the UN family to advance the agenda of adolescents and girls. And we also would like to thank and congratulate UNFPA for organizing this forum. In our view, the fund is uniquely positioned to advocate and deliver for adolescent girls, including the most hostile, in the most hostile and challenging environment. We have immense respect for UNFPA mandate, for the commitment, for the dedication, and for the courage of its staff and leadership. And this is in this context that Canada has announced earlier this week, at the occasion of the visit of Dr. Babatunde to Canada, several contributions to UNFPA core funding and special program, which we hope will make a difference in the life of women and adolescent girls. We are also very proud of being associated with UNFPA and others, UNICEF, UN Women, Plan International, in several events next week, at the occasion of the Commission on the Status of Women, which is also the Commission for Adolescent Girls, event which will put adolescent and girls at the center, at the microphone, on the stage, so that their voice, the voice of the SDG generation, as it was nicely put this morning, are heard loud and clear. I thank you.
Thank you very much, and let me also echo that and to say that we do want to thank the Government of Canada for purposeful engagement with this. Yes, I was in Canada, and Canada has stepped up to fund several of the things we do in the UN system, and we look forward to more engagement as we go forward in implementing the Agenda 2030. Can I then call on the distinguished delegate of Azerbaijan?
The Azerbaijan government works actively to increase adolescent girls' capacity for social transformation by identifying key issues and providing appropriate leadership training for girls to enable them to become effective change agents within their communities. In order to ensure a healthy and active lifestyle for the young adolescent girls and their integration into society, the special strategy for the development of the Azerbaijani youth is being implemented. And the network of information and counseling services for young girls, especially those living in remote and rural areas, have been expanded. Young women and girls have become very active. We organized a special children's forum and children's parliament with the gender equality representation there. So like 50% of the girls and 50% of the boys. And this is very important for development of the leadership skills of the girls. We also jointly with the UNFPA and UNICEF working on addressing the issues of the early marriages. And mostly we work in communities. We can say that in the remote and rural areas, we go from houses to houses, talking with the families. And so we're trying to prevent the dropouts from the schools, and this is very important. But also we are working on the, it's very important on vocational education for the girls, and we used technologies to more investments to the girls' education. It's very, very important. The other issue which we would like to mention is the that during the conflicts, and as a country which actually we have these problems, still occupied territories, adolescent girls are at the greater risk for falling through the gaps of the humanitarian some reliefs, because they have this very big impact of the conflicts on their health, their social integration, and they have this psychological distress. So it is very important. So there is these adolescent girls especially, they have trauma of displacement. They also sometimes, you know, that after the wartime rapes, this is also a big problem. And when they have the traumas, if they have the children, so they also can be stigmatized in their communities. So we especially pay attention to this problem. And I think that the international community also should pay more and more attention to these issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Can I now call on the distinguished delegate of the Dominican Republic?
Muchas gracias. Señor presidente, el contexto actual nos ofrece una oportunidad sin precedentes para nuestro mundo. Con la adopción de la Agenda 2030 para el Desarrollo Sostenible, se establece un camino solidario hacia el progreso y el desarrollo de nuestras sociedades. Y para abordar esta aspiración futura, es preciso atender con firmeza aquellas acciones que atienden al avance de las futuras generaciones, particularmente el de las adolescentes. Sin dejar de reconocer los avances en los últimos años, muchas adolescentes en nuestros países, tristemente, continúan siendo discriminadas y excluidas de acceso a servicios básicos. En adición a esto, las adolescentes que viven en situación de pobreza o marginalidad tienen menos probabilidades a una educación, corriendo mayor peligro de ser objeto de explotación, abuso y violencia. Para ello, es necesario aumentar y aunar nuestros esfuerzos y apoyar a la lucha en donde todavía existe el matrimonio infantil, la mutilación genital femenina y otras prácticas que perjudican el desarrollo de la mujer y las adolescentes. Señor presidente, en el marco de la Agenda 2030 para el Desarrollo Sostenible, se ha logrado tener un objetivo único sobre equidad de género, con el firme compromiso de lograrla y no solo de promoverla. En el objetivo 5, explícitamente, se refuerza la importancia de los derechos de las adolescentes. Además, se hace referencia 11 veces en todos los objetivos de la agenda. También reconoce que es necesario hacer un aumento en la inversión social en áreas como la salud sexual, reproductiva y el bienestar de las adolescentes. Recientemente, el Consejo de Seguridad adoptó la resolución SCR 2250, Juventud, Paz y Seguridad, la cual reconoce la necesidad de invertir en los jóvenes para lograr su potencial y ayudar en el logro de la paz y seguridad en el mundo. Cuando las adolescentes tienen la oportunidad de disfrutar sus derechos, pueden contribuir al desarrollo nacional, ayudando a los estados hacia un crecimiento económico. Veamos, cuando un 10% va a la escuela, el Producto Interno Bruto aumenta en un 3%, cuando reciben un ingreso, reinvierten el 90% de ese ingreso a sus familias. En las adolescentes embarazadas, la situación es más difícil, porque suelen ser estigmatizadas y separadas de sus espacios de interacción social. Cuando se convierten en madres, muchas veces abandonan sus estudios y se insertan al mercado laboral informal con niveles de protección socialmente alarmantes. En la República Dominicana, una de cada 5 adolescentes entre 15 y 19 años está o ha estado embarazada, siendo el mayor índice en las poblaciones más pobres. En consecuencia, el UNFPA y ONU Mujeres, con la colaboración de la Vicepresidencia de la República, los Ministerios de la Mujer y la Juventud, así como otros sectores, han lanzado la iniciativa Tú no estás para eso. O sea, decimos en nuestro país, tú no estás para eso. Que en inglés es You are not for that. Orientada a la prevención de embarazo no planificado y a la vez a concientizar a la población sobre la importancia de asumir decisiones responsables. Finalmente, el impacto de invertir en las jóvenes trasciende a través de muchas generaciones. Es importante asegurarse que ellas puedan ejercer sus derechos, perseguir su educación y obtener las oportunidades necesarias para ingresar en el mercado laboral y así asegurar su bienestar, su salud y la prosperidad para sus familias, comunidades y la nación. Cuando se toman en cuenta las experiencias de las mujeres y se escuchan sus voces, se consiguen mejores resultados. Cuando las mujeres progresan, el país evidentemente que avanza. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. I have just one delegation that has requested. If you wish to make an intervention, please let us know. I'm going to call now on the distinguished delegate of Togo to make an intervention.
C'est bon? Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je voudrais tout d'abord me féliciter de l'organisation par l'UNFPA du présent forum et de l'opportunité donnée à la délégation du Togo de partager son expérience sur la prise en compte des adolescentes dans la réalisation du programme de développement durable à l'horizon 2030. Mesdames et messieurs, selon les statistiques nationales, les femmes représentent 51,4% de la population totale. Sur le plan économique, elles représentent 53,7% des actifs contre 46,3% d'hommes. Et compte tenu de leur dynamisme et sous l'impulsion des plus hautes autorités du gouvernement, le gouvernement a mis en place des programmes et stratégies en faveur de l'autonomisation économique de la femme et de la jeune fille. Des actions visant à renforcer les capacités des femmes et des filles dans la production, la transformation et la commercialisation des produits agricoles ont été appréciées. Il est intéressant de noter un appui holistique couvrant à la fois l'accès aux ressources financières, aux capacités individuelles et collectives, aux équipements de production, aux infrastructures sociales et productives, à la scolarisation et à la formation des filles. Entre autres actions et stratégies, il faut noter la mise en place du Fonds national de la finance inclusive avec ses différents produits, et surtout le produit qui donne l'accès des jeunes aux services financiers. La mise en place du fonds d'appui aux initiatives économiques des jeunes, la mise en place du programme de renforcement des capacités des groupements féminins et mixtes sur la gestion des micro-entreprises, la mise en place du programme d'initiative à la création de micro-entreprises à l'intention des jeunes filles en fin de formation professionnelle. L'exécution du programme de renforcement des capacités des femmes sur la transformation et la conservation des produits locaux et surtout des produits périssables tels que la tomate et les mangues et autres fruits. La production des documents sur l'auto-formation des femmes et des jeunes filles analphabètes sur la création et la gestion d'entreprises de la santé de la reproduction en langue nationale et en français facile. La scolarisation et la formation de la jeune fille en réduisant les frais de scolarité au secondaire et à la gratuité de l'école au préscolaire et au primaire. Mesdames et messieurs, le Togo convaincu que l'éradication des violences faites aux femmes et aux filles est indispensable pour leur autonomisation en vue de contribuer efficacement et pleinement au développement durable, à bénéficier de l'accompagnement du Fonds des Nations Unies pour la population au Togo à travers la composante appui à la promotion de la femme, à la lutte contre les violences basées sur le genre et à la prise en charge des victimes dans les interventions suivantes. l'appui à la révision du code des personnes et de la famille, permettant d'éliminer la plupart des articles discriminatoires en 2014. La révision du code pénal et du code des procédures pénales qui intègre les dispositions relatives aux violences basées sur le genre. La réalisation des études, des enquêtes et des évaluations sur le plan national pour apprécier l'ampleur du phénomène de violence dans notre pays, suivi de l'élaboration d'une stratégie de lutte contre ce fléau, ainsi que l'élaboration des argumentaires religieux et traditionnels pour combattre les violences faites aux femmes et aux filles et des supports de communication parents-enfants sur la santé sexuelle et reproductive. L'appui à la réalisation d'une étude et des enquêtes afin d'apprécier l'effet de la loi portant interdiction des mutilations génitales féminines au Togo promulguée le 17 novembre 1998. Ces études et enquêtes ont permis de constater que le taux de prévalence nationale, qui était de 12% en 1996, est passé de 6,9% en 2006 et de 3,9% en 2010 pour la tranche d'âge de 0 à 59 ans. Appui à l'autonomisation économique des femmes entre 2008 à 2015, ayant permis le renforcement des capacités et l'équipement de 120 groupements féminins et mixtes en matière de production et de transformation des produits agricoles. L'appui à la réinsertion socio-économique de 85 femmes opérées et guéries de la fistule obstétricale. L'appui à l'élaboration d'un programme national de lutte contre les grossesses et mariages précoces. Malgré les efforts réalisés dans plusieurs domaines, des défis sont à relever. Et ces défis sont la persistance de l'analphabétisme des adultes en général et des femmes en particulier, la persistance des pesanteurs socioculturels qui perpétuent les inégalités, le difficile accès de la femme aux moyens de production, comme la terre cultivable, les crédits bancaires, la technologie, les informations relatives aux débouchés, la faible mobilisation des ressources financières. Monsieur le Président, en perspective, le Togo, en vue d'accélérer la mise en œuvre des différents programmes, et notre pays compte sur le partenariat entre le Togo et les partenaires techniques et financiers, les OSC et les communautés à la base pour favoriser une synergie d'action dans l'autonomisation des femmes qui profiteront dans le cadre du renforcement de la capacité et de la pérennisation des actions en faveur de l'autonomisation des femmes qui profiteront à tous et aux générations présentes et aux futures en vue d'un développement durable. Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you very much. Now I call on the distinguished delegate of Finland to make an intervention.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Executive Director, honorable panelists, excellencies, colleagues. Thanks to UNFPA for organizing this high-level forum today. I would just like to give a few remarks, and I'm very grateful for a very interesting discussion we've heard today. Finland's development policy continues to have one of its priority areas, women and girls, so that women and girls have strengthened rights and status, and we are very happy to cooperate with UNFPA, UN Women and UNICEF in this area. We heard today how important it is to ensure that women and girls have the rights and knowledge needed to make decisions concerning their own bodies and lives in order to be healthy and able to live actively and participate actively in the societies. Many panelists brought the importance of and the role of education, and of course also comprehensive sexuality education is critical. Another critical area is, of course, protection, work against violence, and a good example of work that's taking place is the UNFPA UNICEF joint program on FGMC, and I was very happy to hear in the steering committee meeting just recently how things are developing. Also, the humanitarian situations were brought out, and I think this is a special area where we need to see education and protection needs are important there as well. And of course, we are very happy that President Halonen has a role now in the Halver Advisory Group that relates to the Every Woman, Every Child initiative. So we look forward to working with all partners with that. I think Deputy Executive Director Gupta brought up the very important question about the scale. And I think this is also something we need to think of together, the system-wide level and the innovative solutions also when we try to reach the SDGs. And to finish, I would have a question to distinguished panelists. As we are thinking of SDGs and how to reach and empower everyone so that no one is left behind. So I was wondering if you would have examples on how to reach and empower also adolescents and girls, especially with special needs. I'm thinking of girls with disabilities and so on, and what kind of work is done in that area. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I don't see any other indication to intervene. And so what we'll do is we'll give the panelists 2 minutes each to make a final comment. And then there was a question on the table, and you might wish to respond to that. And then we would round up. So can I then call on the permanent representative of Peru, Your Excellency?
Muchas gracias, señor Batunde, por darme la palabra y a la vez expresar nuestra complacencia por las importantes presentaciones y también intervenciones de la sala sobre este tema que nos ha convocado hoy día. Yo quisiera concentrar mi comentario sobre un tema que me parece fundamental y que ha sido señalado por alguna de las intervenciones, el tema de la medición y los indicadores. Como todos ustedes saben, en esta etapa estamos en la definición de los indicadores que van a permitir la medición de la implementación de nuestra agenda. Este es un elemento fundamental, creo yo, porque no solamente nos va a permitir establecer las líneas base, es decir, cuál es el nivel del problema en cada una de nuestras sociedades, sino a partir de ahí ir evaluando el progreso que podamos alcanzar. En ese sentido, creo que hay que hacer un esfuerzo especial para analizar cómo está quedando esta lista de indicadores preliminares que ya se están aprobando. Paralelamente a esta reunión está la gente de la Comisión de Estadística. Hay varios indicadores referidos al problema que hemos tratado hoy día. Felizmente han sido considerados específicamente en el objetivo 5 y en el objetivo 16, varios puntos en las metas que miden específicamente la gravedad del problema de la violencia contra los menores, el abuso sexual, todos estos elementos que han sido señalados en las discusiones. Creo sí importante señalar que no todos los países estamos en igualdad de condiciones para medir esto. Los niveles de los institutos de estadística son muy desiguales. Yo creo que se debe hacer un esfuerzo, no solo de toda la comunidad internacional y de los órganos de las Naciones Unidas, para concentrarnos en asegurar que estas estadísticas realmente nos permitan afrontar este problema tan serio de un sector específicamente vulnerable, como se ha señalado, no solamente por el tema de género, sino por el tema de la edad. Para el Perú, como ha señalado Canadá, este es un tema muy, muy delicado. Por eso con Canadá trabajamos en crear, establecer un Día Internacional de la Niña, en la que podamos continuar llamando la atención mundial de la vulnerabilidad de este sector y de todas las amenazas que tienen por delante. Así que creo que esta reunión ha servido nuevamente para llamar la atención y ponernos de acuerdo en cuáles son las prioridades para hacerle frente.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Let me call on Ms. Mutale.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. Let me start with the question that was posed. We haven't had yet developed a very comprehensive strategy for dealing with girls who are ably or differently abled. However, we've initiated a process of collecting statistics as to where these girls are, or the boys, whichever the case may be, because what we've discovered as a country is that traditionally or culturally we've got certain myths and beliefs about children who are differently abled, and we tend to hide them in our homes. So we want to see the magnitude and extent of the problem and the challenges that such families face in bringing up these children, so that we may come up with a robust program to effectively deal with the challenges they face. Furthermore, when we look at the issue of adolescent girls, one of the major challenge we have is culture, because in all these things, our cultural perceptions, the norms and values, especially where we highly value marriage as opposed to education, the chiefs have become central to all this, because they are equal partners in the governance of our country, together with the other people who are elected. So they become central in that they are assisting within the communities to deal with issues of early marriages, GBV, teenage pregnancies, and simply by ensuring that most of the children go to school. So hence you find that most of the chiefs now do even remove girls from marriages. If they find that the girls who've been forced into marriages, they are removed and sent back to school. So we are hoping that this will go a long way in sustaining the development and the milestones that we've already achieved. Furthermore, lastly, maybe it's the issue of having sustainable or effective policies and legal framework. The Constitution, the amended Constitution that our President ascended to, goes a long way in making provisions for eliminating gender-based violence and discrimination against women and girls. However, it's important that we take cognizance of the fact that the attitudes of people, perceptions of people, are important for us to tackle. And hence, the ministry is putting in place programs that will go a long way in educating people in terms of changing of mindset. And I must say here that the UN family and the other cooperating partners have been very forthcoming in that the problems are ours as a nation. However, we do need resources to deal with these programs, and that's where our partners have come in to provide financial resources and technical skills in people who've seen other countries deal with these problems effectively. They share with us so that we do not reinvent the wheel in the way we are tackling our problems. I thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me now talk, let me turn to Maria.
Muchas gracias. En cuanto a la Agenda 2030, implica que estemos en el mismo barco, ¿no? Que nos movamos, tanto sociedad civil, sector privado, gobierno, y que podamos avanzar. Pero es un gran reto, ¿no? Porque eliminar la pobreza, el hambre y alcanzar la igualdad son objetivos muy fuertes. Y en cuanto a que esta Agenda 2030 logre implicaciones y un alcance muy específico en la realidad y las condiciones de vida de niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, implica, por un lado, que su aplicación, tanto en la asignación de recursos como en la armonización legislativa y la elaboración de políticas públicas, sea realizada con una perspectiva de género e intergeneracional. Por otro lado, que responda a la realidad de cada contexto. No podemos pensar que la Agenda 2030 se va a realizar y se va a aplicar de manera indiferenciada a todas las naciones. Tiene que ser adecuada a la realidad de cada contexto. Por último, indicadores específicos a cada población. Y esos indicadores específicos tienen que buscar atender las problemáticas específicas de las niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes. Y en el proceso de implementación considero muy importante la labor que tienen las organizaciones de la sociedad civil, las organizaciones de jóvenes, feministas y de derechos de la mujer, de derechos de niñas, adolescentes y mujeres, en el seguimiento al proceso de monitoreo, de evaluación permanente y de seguimiento a todos los indicadores. Por otro lado, creo que la Agenda 2030 nos permite tener una reflexión y un análisis muy profundo de la manera en la que estamos llevando el mundo actualmente. Y tal cual comenta y hace una crítica a los patrones de producción y de consumo que tenemos. Y coloco esto porque si estamos hablando de desarrollo sostenible, no podemos seguir con modelos insostenibles de desarrollo. Y en ese sentido, si estamos centrándonos en la vida y en el desarrollo de estas niñas, adolescentes y mujeres jóvenes, implica pensar qué mundo le estamos dejando para el 2030. Es todo, gracias.
Thank you very much. Silva?
I think, thank you so much for the question on disabilities and on young people and especially adolescents with disabilities. This is also for us a relatively new area of work, but we have started a small piece of research in the Asia-Pacific region, concentrating on ASEAN, and we are looking at generating perspectives, which we will first start with at the regional level, advocating to ASEAN at. I think that this is a very interesting conversation because sometimes we just look at adolescent girls of a marginalized, vulnerable group due to age and gender, but it is not really a homogeneous group as a whole. And I think especially vulnerable in our part of the world are, of course, indigenous adolescent girls. And we also have to talk about adolescent girls who are affected by migration. So either they have migrated at a young age, they may be undocumented or stateless in other countries. Adolescents who right now, as you can see in the world, are perhaps refugees. And I think that we have to, if we really wanted to make the impact for the least, you know, we have to be looking at these intersections that exist in our communities and in our countries to really make the impact where it really matters. The one point I'd like to say that, you know, while we are presenting our topics in a very nice protected environment, the reality of the situation outside is that religious fundamentalism is on the rise in the world. And I live in a region where you have all forms of religious fundamentalism. So we have experienced Hindu fundamentalism, Buddhist fundamentalism. We have experienced Islamic fundamentalism, and as well as Catholic fundamentalism. So we are home to all of this. And I think that one of the really skillful things we have to navigate as a community that is committed to sexual and reproductive rights is how do we actually balance the arguments and the premises that are made on the right to culture, on the right to tradition, on the right to religion, but ensure that these do not harm gender equality and continue to protect women's rights. So, and this is, of course, a very skillful situation, and we have to find new solutions on how we can balance this, because these are going to be, I think, arguments that we are going to face when we come into, you know, pushing the agenda further. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Sima. María José.
Thank you so much. I would like to elaborate a little about how to strengthen the partnerships, to have effective partnerships in order to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. I come from the civic society, and the direction we have marked is that we would like to strengthen the collaboration and the partnership at national level, in addition to the partnership we have at international level, and for us, mainly to focus on goal number 5. We think that when the countries align their strategies to the 2030 agenda, it's very important to include the civic society, not at the end of the process, but in the beginning of the process, so we can contribute to define what are the priorities and the way we have to go. There's always the decision, would you like to walk one step in 17 directions, or would you like to take 17 steps in one direction? Different countries might have the same problem, but the way they solve is completely different because it depends on the cultures, the traditions, the religions, and the political system. In any case, the methodology that has to be followed has to be very focused. There has to be a clear governance structure and planning. And we also have to add not just the success criteria, but also the stop criteria. Because if something is developing but is not working, we should stop it before we have spent too much time or money on it. I think in SONTA, the 30,000 members in 67 countries were eager to cooperate with other NGOs, with the governments in a very defined way. We would like to help the leaders in prioritizing what has to be done. We envision a world in which women's rights are recognized and respected as human rights, a world in which women have access to all resources and are represented in decision-making positions on equal basis with men, a world in which no girl or woman lives in fear of violence. We're here for you. Come and talk to us, and we will work with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, María José. Gita, the last word of wisdom.
Thank you. I just was sitting here thinking, this is such a massive agenda. It often feels overwhelming when you think of FGM, child marriage, violence against girls, the lack of education, the number of girls who are still out of school, girls living with disabilities. There's so much to do. And I'm struck by a comment that was made by the panelist on my right, Myra, when she said it's ultimately about a balance of power issue. It's the imbalance of power between the genders, between women and men, between the adults and the youth that is intersecting for adolescent girls in a very particular way. And it, I think it's easy to put that down to culture, and then it becomes very difficult to deal with because it seems like it's immutable. But I think I'd like to leave you with two thoughts. If you think about what gives us power in society, it's quite easy to define. You get power in any society if you have access to information and education, if you have access to income and employment or property, if you have access to services of any kind and technologies that go with that, if you have access to social support, and if you have access to voice to be able to speak up. So once you identify what are the sources of power, as governments, civil society organizations, multilateral organizations, the private sector, each of us can play a role in helping adolescent girls increase access to each of those sources of power. And in doing so, we might begin to rectify the imbalance that exists in our world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gita. That's truly wisdom. I will close by actually starting from where you stopped, Gita, in terms of power, because I think that the resolution of what we are talking about is the negotiations of space for this demographic in every situation they find themselves. I want to also challenge the very notion of culture in many circumstances, and that people recede into that space to explain many things. But in point of fact, it is, for me, sometimes not acceptable, because we then don't challenge that power structure which actually is constructed as culture. And I try to address this in my mind many times because I personalize it. And I want each one of you to personalize it. Question that I want you to ask is, if you have an adolescent daughter, what would you like her to turn out to be? Whatever culture you come from. Because I think that's really what's going to determine how each one of us engages in this. And I've had occasions in this town where I've spoken to people who have come to me to say, you know, we don't believe in this issue that you're addressing with early and forced marriage. And I then ask, do you have a daughter? And he says, yes. Okay, so where is your daughter? Oh, how old is she? He says, oh, she's 12. Where is she? She's in the UN school. So I say, oh, okay, so your daughter can be in the UN school and ultimately would go through and graduate and go to college and then get a master's degree and become somebody. She can do that. But you are telling me that the daughters of those who are on the street in the capital where you come from can be married off at 10 and 11. So I think it's just about personalizing it and seeing, asking yourself, what will you do if you are in that circumstance? And that each one of us must actually take charge of this and be passionate about it in the context of your person. Because your daughter will not forgive you if you marry her away at 10. And not one of us here would do so. And I think it's just about taking that passion to the next level and to the next level and to the next level. And I'm sure we can resolve that. And that applies to just about everything. So that's my first. My second one, of course, is that, and I see and I totally take it here where I say that we're dealing with not just one demographic, even in a country. It is not just one demographic. It's heterogeneous. We have them at different levels, at different localities and geographies. And we have to ensure that we apply universality and leaving no one behind in the country. Universality is not just about sovereignty. It's about country. It's about nations. It's about peoples. So that each person has access to the same opportunities if, in fact, the SDG is going to apply to them. And I believe that we must go away with that also. The next point, is that we must remind ourselves that beyond that heterogeneity, it's also the fact of the issues that have been talked about here. You know, people living with disabilities, different, you know, subgroups of people who actually not only disadvantaged, but they are doubly disadvantaged because we never even think about them or do anything about them. So it has to be universal. It has to be everybody. And I believe that that's the way to go. And of course, remind ourselves that we live in a world of crisis. So as we speak about, you know, those who live on the streets of New York or Kampala or Jakarta, there are people who today are in crisis. And I want to remind you that the world today, there are more crises today than there's ever been in the world. And it's not going to stop. So it's not just about conflict. It's also about the issues we have with the environment and degradation of the environment and the issues that actually put vulnerability of many communities because of the environment. So it's something which we must think about and we must reach out so that even when they're in crisis, even when they're in a place where it's difficult to reach them sometimes, we must ensure that we reach out and include them in our consideration. And the next point I want to make is to talk about boys and girls. I mean, we've talked about girls today. I think it's important to do because when you actually disaggregate data and all of that, they are the most disadvantaged. But I think also to include boys in our consideration. Today, there are more boys caught in the crisis of refugees in Europe than we ever think. And they are going to be a group that we'll have to think about, you know, in order to rescue them and provide them the skills they need for a life. Because some of them are there already, some of them are in transit, some of them are thinking of going. And because of that, they are not thinking of what to do with their lives. And I believe we have to engage with them. And the last point I'm going to make is with regards to the SDGs. You know, Mario Jose, you talked about 17 directions. I think we need to, I want to suggest that we should never think of the SDGs as 17 directions. It is one direction. The SDGs are together, because if we think about them in different directions, the essence of it and the philosophy and the principle of the SDGs will be lost. What we are supposed to do is make them work together, because it is impossible for you to achieve the gender equality goal without looking after the issues of rights, without looking after education, without looking after health, without looking after, you know, the rule of law and peaceful societies. So it all comes together. So in implementing the SDGs, it is a total society approach. It is a total, approach to the 17 goals, and they have to come together. And it is only by so doing that we can actually make their life better for the adolescent girl. And I want to suggest that the entry point to implementing it is that 10-year-old who is waiting for all the things we are going to do to make her, you know, a balanced person reaching full potential when she's 25. I thank you. That is the end of the session. Thank you.